Namaskar. In history, facts are sacrosanct. Today, in the Ghazali program, we have amongst us a very noted personality, the man of the hour. Due to his huge contribution in the field of archaeology, today he has received a very prestigious award, an award with reverence, that is Padma Shri. We have with us Padma Shri Dr. K.K. Mohammed, a man that made international news today due to his efforts in proving a historical fact. On behalf of Prudent Media, first and foremost, at the outset, I would like to congratulate Dr. K.K. Mohammed on being confirmed the very prestigious Padma Shri. Namaskar, sir.
Namaskar. Thank you so much.
It's very nice to have you in Goa.
Thank you so
much. After a long time, you have visited Goa.
Yeah.
It's an honor for us.
Wonderful.
First, at the outset, I would like to congratulate you on behalf of the entire people of Goa.
Yes. Thank you.
On being confirmed Padma Shri. Yeah. How does it feel, sir?
It's really a great and a very joyous moment also. And especially Goa is very special to me, because I had the privilege of working in Goa almost for 7 years, you know. Lot of work, lot of efforts, a lot of conservation works. So all these things had taken place here in Goa, and I was part and parcel of that one. So I have a great gratitude towards Goa and Goan people, because they helped me, supported me like anything.
What is that makes Dr. K.K. Mohammed, your honesty, your stricture, your penchant for facts, and your so much passion and dedicated to archaeology, that you have brought out a very important fact, a very contentious issue of the Ram Mandir Babri Masjid, for which you have received so much of focus, because the whole nation awaited with bated breath to know what would be the verdict of the judge. Yeah. And that verdict was largely thanks to you. So I would like to know, what was this whole issue about Ram Mandir and Babri Masjid, for which you brought about a solution after, and it was going on since the 19th century, finally you brought it to a fruition. Please tell us, what is that whole thing about?
See, the whole thing is, you know, because this problem was going on.
Yeah.
And this was always boiling without any kind of solution for the whole problem.
Correct.
So I was in the excavation team in 1976-77 under Professor B.B. Lal, because he was the excavator.
B.B. Lal?
Professor B.B. Lal.
Lal, okay.
He was the excavator and he was the director of excavation also. Mm. And before that, he was the director general of Archaeological Survey of India.
Mm-hmm.
So excavation has got two processes. Mm. One is the exploration, and the second is excavation proper.
Mm.
Exploration means before the excavation, we just go around the area, look at the whole thing.
Mm.
So I was also doing the same thing.
Mm.
So we went into the controversial mosque also.
Mm.
At that time, there was a police, Pickett was there.
Mm.
But we were from the excavation team, from the research team.
Mm.
So we were allowed in.
Mm-hmm.
So that controversial mosque at that time, even at that time, it was standing on 12 temple pillars.
Mm. It was standing on 12 temple pillars. Okay.
So now the question comes, you know, a pillar is a pillar.
Mm.
What is, can you have any distinction between a temple pillar and a mosque pillar?
Mm.
Of course, if you are a man who is initiated into the subject, if you know the subject, you will know, how to distinguish between a temple pillar and a mosque pillar and a church pillar also.
Yes,
because,
yes,
you know, we are all, initiated into that subject.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was, because, you know, the temple pillars, they will be having mostly in 11th and 12th century, Purna Kalasha. Now, what is Purna Kalasha? It is a pot from which foliages will be coming out. And this is one of the Ashtamangala Chinnas, one of the 8 auspicious symbols in Hinduism.
Correct.
And in 11th and 12th century temples it was there.
Mm.
And then inside this one, there were some sculptures also.
So you saw the Purn Kalash on the pillars?
On the pillars.
All the 12 pillars.
Okay. It was there.
You saw a symbol of Purn Kalash.
Yeah. And then there was a sculpture also inside. And this was very obvious that it has been, I mean, this is the remains of a temple.
Yeah.
And in 76-77, this was not a, whether it is a temple, whether it is this one, it was not such a very big issue.
Correct.
Of course, it was an issue, but not a very big issue. Then, I mean, that was the time of Mrs. Gandhi, and Professor Noorul Hasan was the education minister, because culture was under the education minister. Then, in 1990, some of the leftist historians, they came out, they said that Professor Lal has excavated the place, and he could not get any temple remains, so the Muslims should not hand over the structure. But then Lal,
but when Professor Lal and you were there, but you have said that you have noticed 12 pillars with Purna Kalash.
But so, even he had also.
Yeah.
But the thing is, you know, then Professor Lal had to defend. Because it was not a very big issue.
So the leftist historians refuted
that. They came out first saying that, I mean, Lal had excavated. He did not get any temple remains.
Okay.
So they came out. So then Lal had to defend himself.
Defend himself,
no? He said, we have got the temple remains also. But we did not project itself, you know, because we did not focus on that also. Because it was not a contentious issue, very contentious issue at that time. Then I came for the defense of Professor B.B. Lal. And I was a deputy superintending archaeologist at that time. In Tamil Nadu, in Madras, at that time. I said that I was the only Muslim who had participated in that excavation. And I have seen the temple remains also, the temple pillars also. And further, when we excavated, we got the brick, this one, brick platform, over which the pillars were standing. And a number of sculptures also, that is known as terracotta sculpture. So, and then I said, one is the remains of the temple are there. Number two, it is as important for Hindus as Makkah and Medina are for Muslims.
Yes.
So for Muslims, it is neither associated with Prophet Muhammad, nor associated with any of his companion, nor associated with any of the awliyas of Islam. Had it been so, I too would have stood along with those people. But it had no connection with all those people. And Muslims should willingly hand it over. That was my contention in that letter.
So what you're saying is that mosque had to be handed over to?
To Hindus.
To
because,
Hindus.
You know, because, you know, Hindus cannot change the spot.
Okay.
Because it is believed that it is the birthplace of Lord Ram. So Lord Ram, Lord Krishna, these are certain things, you know. And you cannot take liberty in those things. You cannot change the place from here to another place. Had it been something else, you know, had it been an ordinary temple, they could have made, of course, liberty, they could have transplanted this thing from this place to that place. But in this case, you can, for example, Makkah or Medina, you cannot transplant from this place to another place.
Similar, like in Hinduism. So that place is very sacrosanct,
very
and it has to be in situ, it has to be there itself.
But at the same time, for Muslims, it is simply an ordinary mosque. They can have it anywhere. So that was my contention. So of course, it was opposed by these Marxist people. Then there was another scholar, his name was I. Mahadevan. So he said that one group of people says that there are no temple remains. Another group says, no, there are temple remains. Then why can't we have a second excavation? So that excavation in 2003, it took place as per the order of the High Court of Allahabad. And we had got 12 temple pillars. And this time, the temple pillars were more than 50 in 17 rows.
More than 50? 50.
Yeah, in 17 rows.
Okay, so from 76, then 1990 to now, 2003.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that was, I mean, this means this was a huge temple. It was a very sprawling temple. So that was, and then that was one thing. And the second thing, in 2003, Dr. Mani was the, Dr. B.R. Mani, he was the director of the excavation. And then Dr. Hari Manji, these were the two important people. And I was not there in that in the second excursion.
So you were not there in the 2003 excursion?
No, I was not there. Okay, I was not there. It was under Dr. B.R. Mani and Dr. Hari Manchi. And there were many various other people also. So in that excursion, I mean, one is this temple pillars. Second thing is pranala. What is a pranala? Pranala, every day you have to bathe the deity, if it is Brahma, Vishnu, Mahesh, whatever it is.
Correct.
And the Abhishega Jala goes through a pranala out. It would be always towards north. And that pranala was, it is a Magara pranala. What is Magar? Magar means crocodile. Crocodile face, because had it been a Muslim area, you would not have any kind of living representation. Magara, it is of course banned in Islam. And it is known as haram in Islam.
Okay.
So this Magara, it is a representation of river Ganga. If you go to North India, just in front of that this one Garbhagriha, on the right side there would be a lady standing on a crocodile with a pot, which means that is Ganga. And on the left side there would be another lady standing on a tortoise, which means that is Yamuna. Symbolically you are having a bath in Ganga, Yamuna and underground Saraswati. And then you are going to the Garbhagriha to meet the Lord.
So you saw this in the Garbhagriha?
This was, I mean, this was not in the Garbhagriha. This was, I mean, just outside, because, you know, they had used all these temple pillars, temple architectural members. So that was excavated. And then in North India, in just below the Kalasha, Kalasha will be on the top of the temple. Just below that, there will be Amalka.
There would be
Amalika. 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 Amalika.
Okay.
So that Amalika was also excavated from that place, which means there was a temple, because you cannot have an Amalika, you cannot have a Pranala from a bazaar area. You cannot have it from a residential area also. You have to have it only from a temple area. So that was also excavated from there. And then, because you know, many architectural members of the Shikara of the temple, that was also excavated, which means there was a huge temple. One is the pillars, second is the Amalka, third is the Shikara portion of the temple, and then the fourth one is this, that is the gargoyle, that is the pranala of the temple. And then more than 263.
So the Shikhar was also there?
That was also there.
Now, but see, what we see is the picture of the Babri Masjid. There are three domes. Okay. So those three domes which are there of the Masjid. So below those domes, there was a Shikhar?
No, it's not below that. Because, you know, they demolished the entire thing. Or it was already demolished and it was lying there. So over that, they have built this temple.
Superimposed.
Superimposed, they had built this new mosque. So that was the thing. And then 263 small terracotta idols. So these idols are of cobra. It is of Varaha. Varaha is very important. Malasyakurma Varaha. Narasinghi Vamanathide.
Those avatars.
So, yes, that 10 avatars are there. So that was also excavated from that area. And all the idols were, you know, either human being or some kind of animal or some other thing, you know, pertaining to Hindu culture and civilization.
So in the excavations you all found all these things.
Not me, it was Dr. under Dr. B.R. Mani.
B.R. Mani
and Dr. Hari Manchi. And there were many others also in the excavation team. That was an expert team of archaeological survey of India.
So the Allahabad High Court had ordered this particular excavation in 2003.
So it was on the basis of that one. And so it conclusively proves, you know, that it was a temple area. So on this basis also, Muslims should have willingly handed it over. They should not have taken such an unnecessary tough stand. But many Muslims were ready to hand it over also. Many of them, because I had a lot of discussion with so many people. But the communist historians, you know, they were simply historians. They were not archaeologists. Irfan Habib, he is not an archaeologist. He doesn't know how to do the excavation, how to conduct it, how to, I mean, execute it. He doesn't know. And similarly, Romila Thapar, she is not an archaeologist. So all these people, you know, they came out without knowing the subject. They came out with their own opinion and misled the Muslim community and the Muslim community was carried forward by those people.
Okay.
And finally, that landed
so,
them
so
in trouble.
So, it is these communist historians,
yeah,
such as Irfan Habib, Romila Thapar,
yeah,
who misguided,
yes, misled, misguided them. Misled
okay,
them,
okay.
misguided
this is a very
them.
Important point, sir, because there was so much of miscommunication. And
yes,
the people,
yes, yes.
There was so much of confusion in the mind of
yeah,
Muslims
yeah,
as well as Hindus.
See, see.
So, this is a very important point that it is this communist minded, Marxist minded historian who sort of misguided the whole
misguided
nation.
The whole nation.
This, the historian, these historians are held in high
yeah.
sort of this that whatever they say becomes a gospel truth.
Yes, yes, yes.
Okay, so this
no,
is.
They are very good historians.
Yes,
as
yes.
historians, they
Correct.
Are very good.
Yeah, yeah.
But they had no domain competence to speak on archaeology.
Yes, yeah. yes, yes.
So, and they, I mean, they strayed into a field in which they are not
they
experts.
They are not experts.
Not experts.
Yes,
they
yes.
have no domain competence.
Yeah.
And they started speaking.
Yeah.
And that finally misguided the Muslim community
okay.
also. So,
okay.
I often tell the Muslim community,
yeah.
see, a country like Pakistan was given for the Muslim community. Even after that, you know, if India is a secular country, it's only because of the Hindu majority country. Had it been a Muslim majority country, it would never have been a secular country.
Yes.
So for that, they should be thankful to the Hindu community. And this was a very good opportunity for them.
Yeah.
Had they made this concession at that time, realizing the problem, if they had made a self introspection and then handed over it to the Hindu community, many of the problem from which Muslim community is suffering, that would have been automatically solved.
Yeah. Because this became a very contentious issue, and it became sort of the sort of a huge conflict, a huge
yes,
divide
yes, 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 yes,
in the
yes,
nation
huge
between
divide,
these
huge
two
divide,
communities.
Huge divide.
Okay,
huge
sir. Historically, after the Battle of Khanwa, that when Babur was founding the Mughal Empire in India, he defeated the Rajputs,
yeah,
and
yeah.
Mir Beg, his
yeah,
general,
yeah.
constructed this mosque as a thanksgiving
yeah, yeah, yeah.
In Ayodhya
yeah, yeah, yeah.
in 1527-28.
Yeah, yeah.
So this particular historical fact, which is actually a well-known fact, why were the people not really readily to accept this fact? What was the what was so difficult in why did they contest this fact? Why was that? Was
there was
ignorance
no need,
on
know.
The part
it,
of
it was I mean partly ignorance in some group of people.
Okay,
but partly, I mean, whatever they had done, because, you know, in history, many wrongs have taken place.
Correct.
You cannot right all of them now.
Yes.
But at least there are certain portions, you know, where you can correct the history also, so that, you know, a kind of balanced, I mean, growth of the country can be assured, it can be ensured. But, you know, that, I mean, this was one such opportunity. So that was missed by the Muslim community also. And for which the responsibilities on the leftist historian and some of the leftist media also, because they also played a very important role.
Okay.
Some English media,
oh.
they played a very wrong role.
Okay.
And that ultimately
okay.
landed Muslims, you know,
yeah.
in a very difficult situation.
Okay.
And now the entire brand now they have to bear.
Okay.
It's not the communist historians.
Yeah.
But the Muslim community has to bear the entire brunt of the whole thing.
Correct.
So there, yeah. I mean, things have gone very wrong.
Yeah. So you have sort of clarified the entire this thing, and really hats off to you for this. I would like to come now to your contribution to Goa.
Yeah.
Now, you have done so much in Goa. I remember that time we used to, you know, hold you in high reverence because one thing that we have noticed is your humility and your and you do so many things, but you're very humble about it, very modest about your contribution. Now, what there's so many things that you're doing through ASI in
yeah,
Goa.
Yeah,
How
yeah.
was that experience in Goa? What
it was a wonderful experience,
yeah.
you know, because working, because, you know, this is the first European city outside Europe.
Correct. Yeah.
So there was a Portuguese saying, can we Goa? Excuse the word Lisboa. The one who has seen Goa need not see Lisbon.
Lisboa.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, yes.
And this Rua da Rita,
yeah, yeah.
and many of the roads here, many of the this one churches, like Bom Jesus, the most holiest of the holy, and then Se Cathedral, this one Saint Assisi. All these are, I mean, it's a huge experience for a man who is coming from different parts of the country, and especially from North India, from South India. This is, of course, a foreign country in India. So, working here in these churches, you know, very holy churches, you know, this was a new experience for me also. And Bom Jesus that had developed several cracks. So, that we could stitch together. Similarly, this one, St. Assisi. Similarly, Say Cathedral, Cajetan, St. Paul, all this one, they had a lot of problem. And my intention, my purpose was, you know, this idea was that you have to have, we have a, one is the protected area, then you have a 100 meter prohibited area, then you have a regulated area, that is 200 meters. But for a city like old Goa, you have to have a huge heritage zone where you cannot have any kind of construction except the infrastructural facilities. So, right from that Dambe ground up to St. Paul, the whole area, and from Pillar up to the this one, the river bank, that should be declared as a heritage zone. So that, I mean, you have to, you can, one, a person who comes to this area can very well experience, I mean, what was the old Goa. And all these roads also, that should be, I mean, again renamed after the original name. For example, Rua Dairita. It's a straight road it is. But this was the most happening place at that time. So it should be named after that one. Similarly, the road which was going inside of Bom Jesus, that was Chapelirio, road of Rua do Chapelirio, Hatters Road. Most of the physicians of those period, they used to sit in that area. So all these things, you know, you can recreate the entire thing, ambience. And also you can have a lot of tourists from outside the country. But now what has happened is the whole thing area has been now completely taken over by new construction. And you cannot now revert back to the same old heritage city.
Now, I just last question due to paucity of time. Two questions. One is that that there was some controversy about Inquisition site, where the ASI built an office and all. That is one thing. And are there any chances of you returning to Goa, which Goa is awaiting you?
No, because, you know, because I am now already retired from the Archaeological Survey of
India. You have retired.
I am now 66 years old. Retired from the Archaeological Survey of India. So now there is no question of, I mean, returning back. But at the same time, it's always, I mean, a great opportunity to come back. Relive the old days, and then go back. You know, here there are a number of people whom I had made them permanent on various positions. So they all love us very much. Then the intellectuals of Goa, like Percival Narona. We had a very Sajjan Bhatkar, Dr. Dume. All these people, you know, I was very much attached to them. And I was also able to transplant one temple, that is Kurdi Mahadev temple.
Yes.
So from its original place to a distance of 20 kilometers.
Yeah,
20 kilometers.
Yes.
That was lying there for a long time. So when I came over here, then I saw the condition, because for 9 years it was, after dismantling, it was just lying there. So with the help of Mr. Gangadhar Korgaonkar, with the help of our own Mr. Ranga, with the help of Mr. Gopal Rao, Dr. Joshi, and a group of archaeologists and other people, we could reconstruct them. And
you all transplanted it from its original site next to the Salavali Dam.
That is almost 20 kilometers away from its original.
It was in 86, no sir?
That was in, no, that was in 94, 95.
Okay.
94, 95. So that was the thing which we had completed. And then we had also some other things also, some other Shalolim, there was this one, another temple was there, and all those.
Even the
temples.
Mother Goddess, I think.
That Mother Goddess also, and various other things, you know, we could complete.
About the Inquisition, you could say something?
Inquisition, of course, you know, it was right from 1560, Goa had introduced this Inquisition.
No, the site. Which,
so the site is almost the same thing. It was the palace of Adil Khan earlier, which was converted into palace of Inquisition. So all those things were, you know, there. So it was a wonderful experience to work in a place like this one.
That was Dr. K.K. Mohammed, the man of the hour. It was a great opportunity for us Goans to interview him, know the man. His modesty, his humility is very, very impressionable, and he makes all the difference to so many lives, and more so to archaeology. It gives me a great opportunity to present my book, recently released book, Goa Gold, Goa Silver, Her History, Her Heritage from Earliest Times to 2019. Mention of Dr. K.K. Mohammed is also there. It gives me great pleasure and honor to present him with this book.
Thank you
very much. On behalf of Goa, I would like to thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Yeah.